Just kicking off the second season of French Passions, the first season was a rip-roaring success, is Geoff Dyer, who I'm very pleased to have here speaking about Camus. You, I'm sure, are all here because you're fans of Geoff's as well as Camus, so you will know everything I'm about to tell you about his career, which started off with a book on John Berger, continued through many novels, including The Colour of Memory, which we'll speak about, Paris Trance, and my favourite description of Geoff's work, which is genre-defying books, including Yoga for People Who Can't Be Bothered to Do It, and also a really wonderful book on D.H. Lawrence, which has inspired many others to write biographies differently, out of sheer rage. He recently published a book of essays, Working the Room, and he has a forthcoming book about Tarkovsky's film Stalker, right? Which you can read in February next year, so hold your breath. So I think I'm going to try and persuade Geoff, we've spoken a little bit about this, but try and persuade him to speak about Camus, not just what he means to him, but also how he's influenced his writing. But anyway, let's begin perhaps with your first encounter with Camus.
Yeah. Do you know, I should say that upstairs, Gaby and Hélène were talking away in perfect, fluent French. So it's there's just no limit to Gaby's abilities. And because my first answer is going to be so boring, I guess I should really reassure you that it will get more interesting later on. At least I hope it will. Because I think I discovered Camus in the way that everybody does in this country, either sort of late school or maybe early university. And it was at school, actually, because we were, and I think maybe this trajectory will say something about it, we were doing N.F. Simpson's One-Way Pendulum for A-level. N.F. Simpson, a quite minor playwright. But that meant that we had to read this book, The Theatre of the Absurd by Martin Eslin, and then he talks about the absurd and existentialism, and then you're sort of referred back to Camus and Sartre. And so then, like everybody else, I got into the cult of this lot of French writers, you know, who made writing and the writing life seem glamorous in a way that it certainly sort of didn't in Britain. And this whole thing of sort of resistance, cafe society, that was all interesting. But I remember quite early on, I got a real sort of deeper sense of absurdity because I read this account by Simone de Beauvoir, and she said, "Oh yes, we would work all morning in a cafe, whichever cafe it was, and then we'd go out for lunch." And I remember thinking, Well, where did they go for lunch? Did they go home? Did they go to an office for lunch? But for me at that point, Camus in a way didn't have a distinctive identity of his own. He was just part of that whole sort of French firmament of starry intellectual life.
And then, and so how did he come sort of unhooked from the rest of the train?
Exactly. That's exactly what happened. Where should I start? I wrote this novel, published this novel in 1989, a very sort of lyrical, romantic novel about life in Brixton, and the second half of it.
This is The Colour of Memory.
Is it's this one fantastic summer in London, and I published this when I was 30, and that was the product, in truth, of about, you know, it took about 15 lived summers to get one decent fictional summer out of that book. And I'd always had this just this love of sunlight and everything, and you know, the way that English people always do, precisely because we lack it so much. And then in 1991, partly because of that early exposure to Camus and Sartre, all that sort of stuff, I went to live in France and went down to stay with a friend in somewhere in the south of France, where there was a copy of Camus' lyrical essays, the selected essays and notebooks. And I read these essays that they would be the essays that were originally in Betwixt and Between, and I guess Nuptials. I'm not going to attempt to do the French titles. And it was just one of those incredible things that you have as a reader. Of course, we all read books that we love, but this was just, you know, these are these essays about him growing up in Algiers. And he wrote these two volumes of essays when he was very young, I think, in his early 20s. And it was this sort of vision of had a really visionary quality of a life that was so that I'd only sort of imagined in a way, in one way, because of the weather. And at the same time also, he was describing this life of growing up in extreme poverty in Algeria. And it was, I mean, the sort of kinship I felt with him for reasons of sort of background, which we can get into, it was, I mean, I just felt this amazing spirit. He was a just such a sort of kindred spirit, really. Kin in the sense of, you know, like a brother. And that's, okay, so that's my particular sort of way I connected with Camus. But it turns out, as is so often the case with very particular, highly individualized encounters, it turns out it was also incredibly typical. Because weirdly, it seems to me that Camus has this effect on people. You know, you might like E.M. Forster, or you might like, you know, Maupassant or whatever. But, you know, Camus elicits this love from people. So I was, you know, I shortly after that infatuation I had, that early infatuation, I was reading Susan Sontag on Camus in Against Interpretation, and she was saying, you know, some writers are either, you know, writers, they're either lovers or husbands. And she says, you know, everybody loves. So I think, oh, this is interesting. Of course, Sontag, she's going to claim that Camus is her great lover. And then she says, and for me, Camus is the ideal husband. But this,
not for many other people, it has to be said.
I mean, no, it's really quite counterintuitive. And then this is really quite characteristic. So here we get the French feeling, a French sort of, you know, he just engenders this rapture in people, including, you know, Bernard Henri Lévy. This is what he says about Camus. I have the feeling he had the same sense of humor and liked the same kind of women as I do. I mean,
what? That's not a compliment, by the way.
No, really, yeah. what a quel tosseur. and then it actually gets better, actually. I'm also certain that had he still been alive, he would have been the intellectual, perhaps the only one, to whom I would have shown the proofs of my book, Barbarism with a Human Face. Presumably for Camus, the honour of that would have made the Nobel Prize seem really quite insignificant. You know, so yeah, my very particular reaction, it turns out, is a variant of a quite generalized of a not untypical adoration, which for the man in a way. And actually, Sontag goes on about how handsome he is in these pictures, in his trench coat and all this kind of stuff, you know.
Yeah, I think the trench coat has a lot to do with it. Well, perhaps you can tell us a little bit about your own upbringing, because just so people know what the kinship consists of in some way.
Yeah, surely. I forgot to. Yeah, this was 1991, so it's important to stress that this kind of affair I had with Camus was before The First Man was published. Mm-hmm. But, and I always think it's nice to give the audience, you know, they. In the age of the PowerPoint, people get bored if there's nothing to look at. The great Herbert Lotman biography, it's a substitute for a PowerPoint. The Herbert Lotman biography was published, and he'd had some. I don't know if he had access to the manuscript of The First Man, but he certainly knew a lot. And Camus was describing this childhood, which was. Actually, let me go back another stage. I mean, the process I'd gone through of growing up in a sort of working class family with no books at all, and then, you know, in a classic sort of way, a teacher at school took me under his wing. I became interested in literature and started passing exams and ended up at Oxford. And of course, there's a lot of signposting available for us in Britain. You know, it starts with, you know, Jude the Obscure as the doomed sort of forerunner. There's Sons and Lovers by D.H. Lawrence. There's Raymond Williams, who was a hugely important guide for me. It seems to me that that's what happens when you're going through this process. You're looking for guides. And then there was Tony Harrison, you know, really, really important, but all within a very, it made me think this process I'd gone through was a peculiarly British grammar school type thing. And I mean, it really is, it's very well trodden, and the symptoms are always the same as a way of being educated out of the background you come from at the, you know, in some, you lose something as well. And there's that sort of, you know, there's this whole feeling that what's happening to you, you can't articulate to your parents, all this kind of stuff. Anyway. And then, you know, the realizing that Camus had undergone the most vast, you know, the biggest version of that, that journey possible, you know, when, you know, his, you know, the teacher turns up at his home and says, you know, to Camus' mum, you know, I think you should let him sit for the whatever it is scholarship, you know. And then for him, it just goes on this sort of unbelievable scale, so that, you know, when he sends a telegram to his mum saying he's won the Nobel Prize, you know, the neighbor has to read it to his mum because his mum's illiterate. So this just sort of gave it, this took that experience outside of this rather, let's say, parochial English thing, and made it seem something that was, yeah, just sort of a universal, really, I think. Now, there's one crucial thing that we didn't share, because, you know, I grew up with a mum and a dad, but, you know, it's Camus, I think it's quite interesting. Of course, his father was killed in the Battle of the Marne in 1914 or 15, when Camus is just 1 year old. And just seemed to me recently, I don't know if anything's been written about this, but that that phenomenon of French writers whose fathers were killed in the First World War, you know, Roland Barthes, of course, his dad died, I think, in, I can't remember the exact year, but died when he was when Bart was a year old. Then a slightly different example, you know, Althusser, his uncle was killed in the First World War, but, you know, in that, I don't know whether it's just Althusser being a total loony, but he was under the impression that his mum wanted to marry that uncle, and that he should have been the uncle's son. And, you know, nutty old Althusser believes that that's why he was called Louis, him. But, you know, he's off his head, of course. But anyway, it's quite interesting, that thing, I think, the absent father. And certainly in, now, just to give a little, this won't be a spoiler, but in The First Man, there's a really poignant scene where the autobiographical figure is getting sort of bullied at school, and he's accused of being a teacher's pet. And the teacher says, yeah, some of these boys are my pets because I fought in the First World War, and I'll always afford some extra level of succor and encouragement to these boys who, you know, who lost their father. So, you know, then that has sort of significance for later on, I think. So what that means effectively is this, you know, this famous thing, French education, the French state becomes it occupies a kind of, you know, big, you know, sort of a paternal role for Camus, I think.
Mm, that's really, really interesting. That whole generation that was adopted by educators in
a
way,
indeed, yeah.
As a kind of I don't know, a form of fellow feeling with their lost fathers.
There's something very interesting. Geoff wrote an essay years ago about going, we'll talk about this, about going on a pilgrimage to Algiers in search of the disappeared Camus, and also, as you put it very nicely, to claim kin with him. And in that, you have a lovely passage where you talk about one's relationship to one's roots, sort of leaving them, but also being dependent on them, and then having obligations to them, so that, you know, the fact of having emerged from that environment leaves you with this quite complicated relationship, not just having disappeared and moved on, but feeling that you owe a debt, and also that they have given you something, those roots. I mean, what is your feeling about that in your case and Camus?
Yeah, well, it's incredibly strong. It's this strange, I mean, it's, and this is why I was so, why the discovery of Camus was so important to me, because it took me out of this English chippiness. But just to give you an example of, I mean, it's, who was it said, the anecdote is the lowest form of knowledge, but sometimes I think it's quite, so my, when we lived in Camden for a while, and my wife's lovely, nice, upper middle class parents came to stay, they could not be nicer, and they had some sort of interaction with the downstairs neighbours. And they couldn't be nicer. And I then managed to conjure up some absurd sort of errand to sort of some sort of excuse to have some sort of dealings with our downstairs neighbours, because I couldn't bear the idea that they might be under the impression that I came from an upper middle class background. And this is so sort of English, this stuff, but nothing, I cannot bear to be class identified. And it regularly happens that people, you know, that I meet people and they, you know, they, in this sort of a crazy way, they think, you know, oh God, you don't sound working class or whatever. And it's funny, what they can't know, and this is what anybody who's been through this process knows, is that you remain of the class that you were born into at the deepest, at the core of your being. And for nobody exemplifies that more than Camus. And then that has, you know, enormous political implications for him later, with that, you know, famous misquoted thing, you know, when he says, you know, God, well, you know, it's when he's getting the Nobel Prize in Stockholm. God, I have an awful sense that at some subliminal level, I'm sort of pitching for a Nobel Prize tonight.
Yeah, your mother will read the telegram any minute. And
yeah. So that thing when he says, you know, but I love justice, but I'll always opt for my mother above justice, or whatever it was exactly. And then he says, you know, he's writing the first man for the one person who can't read it, you know, his mother. And this, you know, this stuff goes on, it operates at so many levels. There's a lovely anecdote in one of the biographies when he calls his mum and he says, oh, you know, I had... you know, I was meant to have lunch with the president of France the other day, but I cancelled it. And she said, ah, yes, you're right. You know, they're not, you know, he's not our sort of people. And it's that kind of thing is so, you know, is so, and, you know, Camus was, I mean, all sorts of things, of course, lie beneath the break with Sartre. But, you know, you can, there's all the sort of, there's, you know, the ideological stuff, there's all this kind of stuff. But, you know, at some level as well, that where they were from was important, because, of course, Sartre, from his incredibly privileged background, was, you know, felt free to reject the Nobel Prize, or, you know, didn't set any great, you know, and then people complained about Camus that he was maybe too seduced by sort of elegant French or all this kind of stuff. And Camus said, you know, Sartre was never really an influence on me. You know, the light where he was born, Havre or wherever it was, it's so different to my light, the light of Algeria. You know, so that whole thing of Camus' childhood was so, it determined him absolutely. And then, I mean, again, not to preempt stuff that I'm sure we'll come on to, all of this sort of stuff that I had an inkling of in reading the essays and stuff, then it's absolutely confirmed by the first man.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting that, because the first man is an autobiographical unfinished novel, right? And as you say, it would have become, had it had more drafts, it would have become, if not less autobiographical, then at least more of a novel. And the essays, I mean, there must be something to the fact that your discovery of him in this moment is through nonfiction, or even you might say through nostalgia. I mean, it's not just lyricism, is it? It's a looking back at a childhood. I mean, more so than the fiction, would you say?
Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah, because, you know, of course, I'd read The Outsider, and you know, we at university, we all thought we were so clever because we knew that that song by The Cure, the charmingly titled Killing an Arab, we knew that was about Camus and, you know, existentialism, blah, 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 all this sort of stuff. But really, I mean, the great things about that novel, I think it's not so much the existential stuff. It's that real sensual physical immediacy with which, actually, I suppose there is an existential, with a small e, element to that as well. But it's the way that it's all evoked so exactly. And then I think with the other novels, they're sort of problematic in a different way. But yeah, certainly it was these lyrical essays rather than the two sort of philosophical works, The Rebel and The Myth of Sisyphus, that did it for me. And it seemed to me that the Rebel and The Myth of Sisyphus, although Camus had some sort of training in philosophy, although Sartre, of course, was, you know, he sort of pissed on him from a great height when they fell out, saying, oh, you know, Camus could never really understand philosophy. I mean, he had to, in a way, hold back, I think, some of the things that were, that made him made him a great writer. I don't think that sort of abstract thought came naturally to him. Mm-hmm. So that for me, the best, parts of The Rebel are the bits where he's talking about Nietzsche, you know, the philosopher who's sort of not a philosopher. And I don't know, that was another sort of straight in the sort of triangulation of affinities, that the way that Lawrence, who'd been such an important figure for me, and Camus, the way that we all loved Nietzsche, that was just another this weird thing that wrapped me closely to Camus, I think.
So in 91, where were you in your writing life? And were you in Paris then? Is that when you, this is when you went to Algiers, but is it also when you went to Paris or moved to Paris?
Yeah, I was living in Paris, but in a really quite ridiculous way, you know, because I'd done O-level French, but I mean, when I got there, the idea of trying to speak French seemed so difficult that I didn't even try. And so I was friends with John Berger, and he'd spend some time in the suburbs of Paris, excuse me. And, you know, I'd go around there for dinner, and, you know, it's John Berger's place. So one night there was, you know, Cartier-Bresson around there, and it's John Berger's house. So as well as Cartier-Bresson, there'd also be the local plumber who, you know, and there was me, this English bloke, who sort of didn't make any attempt to speak French, you know, so it was preposterous in a way. But then I went to Algiers on this kind of just mad, lonely pilgrimage. But of course, I was savvy enough to have got commissioned to go there for a magazine. And it was just like people coming to London now in search of Chaucer, well, Dickens's thing. I mean, there was, because first of all, for all sorts of understandable reasons, Camus is not, you know, he's not Algeria's favorite son. And then just in terms of the literal navigation of the place, all the roads have been renamed and all the street, you know, so I found it really difficult to find the place where he grew up, this one-story house in Belcourt, you know, sort of poor working-class neighborhood. Then I did finally sort of get to what I thought was the place, and I had to ask about 10 people before finally I came across somebody who said, yeah, I think that's where... Yeah, I think that might be where Camus lived. There's no sign or anything like that. But with just a bit of imaginative projection, you can see, yeah, this is the place where Meursault whiles away that Sunday afternoon in The Outsider, and then there's a few other. But I mean, literary pilgrimage is always a bit crazy, really. But and then finally, I went to Tipasa. You know, where there are two great Camus essays, one that he writes as a young man celebrating the great free love of nature and sun, all this kind of stuff. And then the other one, The Return to Tipasa, which he writes when he's much older and burdened by all the kind of conflicts he has about the Algerian War. At least I think I've got the dates right. And that was, you know, and that's where there is his Camus' friends there's this tiny memorial there where they quote a line where they've scratched on the stone, and it's just about legible, those famous, this is where I will probably get ejected from the premises for my awful accent. You know, ici je comprends qu'on s'appelle gloire, le droit d'aimer sans mesure, which Gaby will translate for those of you who are, who couldn't quite do, make out what I was saying.
Go on.
But anyway, so here I've actually, I can't even remember what it is now, but the right, you know, this is what is wonderful, the right to love without measure or qualification. And there's something really, really lovely about it, because it is so unmonumental, and it's in the process of being rubbed clean, really. So it's not an official monument at all.
It's interesting, the idea that Camus should live somewhere else, you know. I mean, he lives, that's not where he's most important, or that's not really where he remains, and yet, you know, he's in people's minds in this very passionate way. I mean, your description of people sort of falling in love with him or thinking that he should be their husband or that they have a personal connection to him, I mean, it's quite interesting. It's interesting about literature, the way that the transfer is made, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, so, you know, I mean, as we all know, he was in an impossible situation during the Algerian War. Mm. So it's not surprising that somebody who sort of ended up in all sorts of, you know, tacitly, I guess, supporting the army of pacification, it's not surprising that, he's not popular in independent Algeria. But I think also at the time of his death, you know, his reputation was very much in decline, and maybe he's still not popular among sort of French intellectuals, if I can remember, if I remember things correctly, when I, you know, in sort of 1991, I guess that then changed with the publication of the First Man. So, yeah, so I think maybe it was one of those things where, you know, his reputation had remained sort of intact here in the English, in the Anglo-Saxon world, perhaps more than was the case in France. Mm. I realised I'd forgotten to answer one of your questions, Gaby, that in terms of my own writing, weirdly,
oh, yes,
by then the kind of, I'd sort of, exactly in a way that is about right with somebody of my age, I think I was sort of moving towards the end of the sort of lyrical phase in my, in writing. So I think that's another way that it had that kind of either nostalgic or sort of slight elegiac pull to it. And then I suppose this is not altogether surprising. Of course, I was rereading those early essays of Camus in preparation for tonight. And in a classic way, I found that they didn't. You know, the magic, I'd be being dishonest if I claimed that once again, you know, our passion was reignited, because I felt some of the lyricism just a bit much, in the way that I'd felt that that Camus' Mediterraneanism and his, what would you call it, his solarism, mm-hmm, could in some ways explain the idea, could excuse the ideological shortcomings. I felt that was a kind of, and I feel that I'm much more in sympathy with the sort of Edward Said line on him, I think.
Yeah, that's a bit of a fudge, that the sun should cover up the rest. Yeah. Yeah, well, we'll talk about his politics in a second. He's got a great phrase, actually, an invincible summer. It is a lot to do with that, isn't it?
That's another sort of interesting sort of parallel with, you know, you're always trying to think, who is the English equivalent of Camus? And I think really it would have to be Orwell. Mm. Similar kind of thing, really. You know, there's the fiction, but there's the non-fiction, all this
the
kind of stuff.
Dodgy politics, yeah.
Yeah, and, you know, what do we always say about Orwell? He's the sort of wintry conscience. Mm. So I love that sort of contrast of the wintry, you know, English sort of, you know, ravaged old Etonian, mm, versus this sunburnt, you know, Algerian with the unconquerable summer, yeah, in him.
Yeah, that's interesting. I mean, I thought we should perhaps talk a little bit about The First Man. I mean, what was your experience of that coming out? You were just saying that it changed people's impressions of him or interpretations of him. And what kind of an event was that for you?
Yeah, it was funny. You know, goodness knows, I don't need to tell you this, Gaby, but occasionally there are these, you know, books are published, but occasionally there are these things which are publishing events. and that really was an event. And it's quite interesting, I think, that it had taken the Camus estate so long to, you know, to get round to this. Partly because I think his reputation had been so tarnished, I guess, by for ideological reasons. Then this book comes out, and I had two reactions. One was, first of all, God, I was absolutely right. You know, that thing of his being so formed by this experience was absolutely essential to him. Secondly, it seemed to me it was a book which completely made good a lot of the shortcomings of the other fiction. And it was a very, very old-fashioned book. I mean, the beginning is straight out of Thomas Hardy, really. And it also, it's undisguisedly, it seems, autobiographical. So there's incredibly poignant, moving descriptions of this boy having undergone this, you know, this sort of process of being the scholarship boy. And, there's a bit where he has to give his mum's occupation, and he's never been asked to do that before, and he's never even thought what it is. And the teacher says, well, say charwoman. And then, you know, and Camus feels a sort of shame doing this. And then he feels, a great phrase, he feels ashamed of his shame. So there's all this very, very intimate stuff. But then also, crucially, even if you buy in wholeheartedly to the... let's call it the ideological critique of the novels, this book, The First Man, answers that completely. It's a book entirely about Algerian history, who Algeria belongs to, and his wrestling with all of this stuff. And it would have, it exists only in this draft stage, but it seemed to me, it was absolutely going to be it seemed highly likely that it was going to be a book which completely secured his reputation. And I found it, not surprisingly, unbelievably moving, partly because of the poignance of its being unfinished.
Mm. Yeah, that's interesting, isn't it?
He referred to it, Camus had his pompous side, which we might talk about, but he referred to it as his War and Peace, and there seemed to be an element of justification in that.
If only that had been unfinished, it'd be quicker to read. Yeah. Do you really think it overturns our perception of his politics, that book?
I have this great fear of getting out of my depth here, but if I understand it correctly, the problem with The Outsider is, on the one hand, you've got this very, very precise depiction of life. It's all there very, very visibly and tangibly. But this thing of the French presence in Algeria, the colonial reality is overlooked. So, as I think it's to put it in the simplest terms, he kills an Arab, not a man. Mm-hmm. And this kind of slight fiction of a sort of French court in Algeria, all of this kind of fudging, and then then the problem is, of course, even greater in the plague, I think, where I don't know how deeply we want to get into this, but as we all know, the plague is not just a plague in Iran; it's meant to be a symbol of the Nazi occupation of France. So all of these people are, they're these heroic doctors and stuff. They're opposing the plague and the occupation. But of course, it's set in Iran, and these people are actually themselves symptoms of this pestilence. Because from the Algerians' point of view, from the point of view of the Muslims, they are themselves an occupying force. So there's sort of huge problems with that, and there's a bit where they go into what he calls, I think, the sort of native quarter, and the streets are eerily deserted. And it's true, because they've been sort of, imaginatively ethnically cleansed. It's this combination of always the sort of allegorical design of the books versus their very specific locations. And, then he addresses this, it seems to me, or he resolves this in The First Man, because it's in a definite place and it's dealing with these, with these big historical issues. And crucially, the Muslims or the Arabs, they're there all the time. He's wrestling with this stuff.
So you're saying that the removal of the element of allegory rescues him from the criticism that he's been subject to.
Yeah, I think also as well, maybe just the incredible sort of the impossible political and ideological bind that he'd found himself in with regard to the Algerian war. You know, that maybe the wrestling with that and his sort of famous retreat into some sort of what Tony Judd calls his impotent silence. You know, of course, if you're you know, once he sort of pretty much abandons sort of political commentary, well, maybe that allows a kind of, you know, a quieter way to be a sort of, you know, a straight down the line imaginative writer. But even this thing of allegory is so, I mean, allegories are, you know, they're interesting because they so rarely do what you want, what they want, what the writer wants them to do. So, I mean, so yeah, so it's this allegory of you know, against the occupation. And it's quite interesting the way that the allegory starts undermining Camus' stated intention. So as the bodies start piling up, you know, these heroic people who Camus says are great because they're just doing their job, they're just going about their business, they're just doing their job quietly, brackets, which of course was famously the Eichmann defense, the way that they have to cope with this increasing number of dead and corpses, it becomes quite an interesting passage, this, I think, if you bear in mind that criticism of the plague, that the very people he's saying are the you know, the defenders against the plague are themselves maybe are themselves symptoms of a kind of pestilence. So he says this meant the number of dead, this meant that the old crematorium east of the town outside the gates had to be utilized. Accordingly, the east gate sentry post was moved further out. Then a municipal employee had an idea which greatly helped the harassed authorities. He advised them to employ the tram line running along the coastal road, which was now unused. So the interiors of tram cars and trailers were adapted to this new purpose, and a branch line was laid down to the crematorium, which thus became a terminus. During all the late summer and throughout the autumn, there could daily be seen moving along the road, skirting the cliffs above the sea, a strange procession of passengerless trams swaying against the skyline. The residents in this area soon learned what was going on, and though the cliffs were patrolled day and night, little groups of people contrived to thread their way unseen between the rocks and would toss flowers into the open trailers as the trams went by. And in the warm darkness of the summer nights, the cars could be heard clanking on their way, laden with flowers and corpses. So, I mean, it's an allegory. And, you know, the kind of imagery there cannot but associate these people who are the resistors to the occupation with, you know, the very worst crimes of Nazism. So I think it's, and Camus must have been aware of the sort of strange overtones in that passage. But yeah, I think it's always interesting, you know, the most interesting parts of these allegories are the bits where they start breaking free of their intended purpose. So for me, that passage now is much more interesting than the bit to, you know, the conclusion, if you like, that Camus comes to, which I, for many years, there were two passages that I kept in my wallet. One was from Raymond Williams, the other was from Camus at the end, when he says, you know, so let's just consider what is it we learn in times of pestilence, and he concludes, there is more in men to admire than there is to despise. Seems to me we have to add a caveat to that, you know, which is it depends, or not always. It depends crucially on the circumstances, which of course is the one thing that the allegory always wants to lift the story out of the realms of.
The circumstances. Yeah, that's so interesting. And also, it seems to me that as you're talking, you're really interested in who Camus is despite himself. You know, so he, the places where the allegory breaks down, the things that he doesn't quite intend, the writer that he turns out to be in the end and in the beginning, and all these things that he somehow done in the middle that were very, very intended, are less interesting.
Yeah, that's right. And that's, you know, that is in effect what the sort of the critics of Camus, Edward Said most obviously, and also Connor Cruz O'Brien, you know, they, in one way or another, they at greater or at lesser or greater length, they end up coming, you know, they're repeating Sartre's claim, you know, that he's an accomplice of colonialism.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, what's your view about Said now, that comment?
Yeah, do you know, when I first read the Culture and Imperialism, which was in the depths of my Camus infatuation, I was just so outraged by it. I mean, you know, I really could not be more sympathetic to the Palestinian cause and for Said as a representative of that. Of course, it's great, all this kind of stuff. But I had a really basically chippy sort of loyalty to Camus. I felt, you know, here's this Said. These things are always complicated, but, you know, grows up with this musical education, this Camus grows up, he says, in a house that doesn't even have a radio in it. And it was just, I had this blind sort of love of Camus. And I felt that really, in some strange way, Connor Cruz O'Brien's analysis of the kind of ideological shortcomings of Camus, these books were such a crucial bit of my, God, the audience is so young, so most people here won't know the great importance of the Fontana Modern Masters series. In some ways I felt that Said's argument was less nuanced than this one which had come before. And, mm-hmm. you know, he really does make Camus out to be no more than the kind of inevitable terminus of a prior history of colonial histories, of French histories justifying and legitimizing the French presence in Algeria. And, you know, rereading it just yesterday, I started to be more, I realized that the Said argument was more nuanced and more persuasive than I'd been able to admit earlier on.
That's interesting. I mean, I want to leave some time for your questions, but just a couple of things. I mean, one is, do you think anyone will be looking to Camus for Arab Spring sort of context?
That is really interesting, isn't it? I wonder, I mean, because in a way there is, I mean, yeah, that you can go to Camus, and this is one of the sort of things that de Beauvoir and Sartre ended up saying about Camus, that, yeah, he had all this, you know, he had all this rhetoric. So, you know, there's plenty of lovely quotations you can go to Camus for. I think Sontag is so great. This is an early essay of hers when she says, you know, the appeal of Camus really was that he started off from this premise of popular nihilism and then always ended moving, using that to move towards a humanitarian or humanistic kind of thing, which, of course, you know, you can see the appeal of that. So, yeah, there is a lot of stuff in there. And, you know, there's this, but I feel there is a degree, you know, the Sartre de Beauvoir criticism of Camus, it's, yeah, there is a lot of rhetoric there. There's a sort of degree of grandiloquence, and, you know, there's this, I think by the end of his life, there's no doubt at all that this, you know, that this man of noble feelings, I mean, the noble feelings had become a bit the Nobel feelings. So I think there's a quality of sort of Nobelese about it. And then I suppose there was another element. This is a parenthesis. I'll return to the question. But there was something I didn't like about Camus as I learnt more about him, and it seems to me there's no doubt at all that Camus did become rather pompous. Mm. And, you know, they were, you know, I think it was de Beauvoir who said, you know, he always, you know, he had a sort of mobile pedestal with him. And, you know, in terms of sort of Lawrence and Camus, I mean, what I loved so much about David Herbert Lawrence, you know, there was a letter where he says, you know, at some level, I'm still just the same our Bert that rushed with such joy down to the local farm. Okay, so I love that aspect of him. Then I read this story where Camus, always on telly, of course, appearing about things, he was getting ready for a sort of sound check, and apparently the producer called out to the sound man, who happened to be called Albert. Hey, Albert, can you just check that? And Camus snapped, "No, c'est Monsieur Camus." At that point, I think, oh, what a total utter prick, you know. But anyway, in terms of the sort of political uses of Camus now, I don't know about the Arab Spring, but I was surprised that more use wasn't made of him that he wasn't ideologically co-opted for the war on terror, of course, because it was, you know, in some ways, I think that, you know, his principled rejection of terror on the grounds that it strikes blindly, that they might blow up my mum when she's shopping in the market. You know, there's, you know, that had obvious kind of ideological currency in the best way, I think.
And just lastly, I mean, how have you, now that you've been rereading these things, how have you found either that your view of Camus has changed or that you seem to have changed as a result? I mean, has it made you discover something about the sort of lag in the time, reading time?
Yeah, it's funny, really. It's more this sort of sense of, you know, who would there be like Camus now? I mean, just the sense of vocational obligation that goes with being a writer at that time, really. The way that you're immediately drawn into, you can't opt out of these huge political ideological debates, you know. So I always think of that great Sartre line, although I can't remember where it's from, you know, where he says, yeah, there's, you know, you can write about flowers and birdies and all this sort of stuff. This is a time of sort of nuclear fear, but he says, you know, but if you're frightened of dying like a rat, then you can't be altogether sincere in your little birdie poem. So I mean, just that, the pressure of the force of history, which again is another thing where, you know, another identification with Orwell. You know, Orwell says, you know, I'd love to have just devoted myself to being a writer like Henry James, but the political necessity of the times, they've forced me to become a pamphleteer. With the sneer they taught him at school, Raymond Williams brilliantly adds, because of course Raymond Williams thinks there's nothing wrong with being a pamphleteer. So I think that sort of that vacation of the role of the writer as some sort of public intellectual is both a good and a bad thing, I guess, in a way. You know, John Berger more than anybody would incarnate that. You could say Christopher Hitchens, but of course the thing about Hitchens, great, you know, great sort of contrarian and political commentator, but not, you know, he's never been a writer of fiction, you know. He's so that, you know, he was you know, he sort of limited from the start. So that would be my main sense of just the sort of the high stakes that these people were playing for. And I rather liked the way that in their falling out, you know, because as you all know, there were all sorts of tensions simmering, you know, right from the beginning. You know, you've got you know, gorgeous Camus and pug ugly Sartre, you know, you've got that from the start. But then, you know, the falling out was the review of The Rebel that appeared in L'Etat Moderne, and you know, it's a big ideological thing. But, you know, Sartre said, you know, what a shame that we're falling out over a petty author's, you know, a bit of petty author's egotism. So yeah, that I think that would be my mindset, my main sense of the high stakes. But then, you know, ultimately, of course, when Camus retreats into this kind of embattled silence, then ends up just writing, you know, what I think would have been, you know, ends up just being a pure kind of writer again.
That's interesting. Thank you. So should we have some questions from you? Sorry to leave it so long before you're allowed.
Yeah, Lawrence would be the one whereby it where the same thing happened. This to go from a sort of relationship with the books to feeling this complete obsessive adoration of the person. I think they're the only two that really tend to do that. And then since then, I've had all sorts of, you know, crazy phases of writers whose writing I've really loved. You know, God, I went through I'm only about 2 years out of my Thomas Bernhard rehab, you know, but you know, I wasn't in love with Thomas Bernhard, the man. You know, I went through a kind of mad Joseph Brodsky phase, but, you know, was never impassioned about the man. I mean, loads and loads of people as writers, maybe, no, I can't think of anyone else. I mean, a kind of some kind of Martin Amis obsession, just as Martin Amis is this sort of Mick Jagger-like figure, but that's all of an altogether different level. So no, I think it's pretty much. I think it's pretty much just. Oh God! Also, John Berger, of course. I always forget the most obvious one. Yeah, those three. The crucial thing in The First Man is these Arabs who've been pretty much conspicuous by their absence, apart from the moment in L'Étranger, as you say, when he gets killed. There's a description here of he talks about these fights that he would see a lot as a kid. It's a scene he describes the way a crowd would gather if a fight broke out between a Frenchman and an Arab. The Frenchman who was fighting would, in backing up, find himself confronting both his antagonist and a crowd of somber, impenetrable faces, which would have deprived him of what courage he possessed had he not been raised in this country, and therefore knew that only with courage could you live here. And so he would face up to the threatening crowd that nonetheless was making no threat except by its presence. I think that's an extremely interesting passage with reference to L'Étranger, and also in terms of its sort of, we were talking about allegory early on. Sure enough, they are a threat by their presence, by their numbers, precisely because it's their country. So I think at some level, these kind of scenes that Camus would have, that he evidently saw as a kid growing up, you can see how you isolate one of those encounters, give it a kind of, give it that sort of existential sun and sea dazzle, and maybe you end up with the kind of scene in L'Étranger that you've...
But was Camus totally French?
I think his mother was of Spanish origins, if I remember rightly, and I can't remember where his father was from. But I think his father was a sort of an immigrant of some kind. But I think what happened is that as a result of undergoing this sort of French educational system, he sort of became French. And in terms of his, I think this is another shortcoming perhaps, in terms of the way he depicts Algeria, he's entirely looking north towards Europe. And so to put it in a really, really, in a way that's perhaps so crass as to be stupid, but for him the Sahara is a sort of huge beach. It's the Mediterranean that he's drawn to, not Africa. When I first moved to because I could, although I couldn't sort of speak French, I thought I could read it. So I would go down the newsagent and I'd sort of, what paper do I get? Well, I get Libération. Impossible, and the thing about Camus that stylistically it's quite easy to read. So I was able to read those essays, Leyte and whatever. I was able to read them sort of haltingly in French, and similarly with L'Étranger. I at some point I've read in French, and I've also read it in the more recent American translation, because first of all, of course, I read it in the Stuart Gilbert translation, and then it's been recently retranslated into American because Camus, I think, was very much under the influence of sort of Chandler and Hemingway and so forth. And they translated it not as The Outsider, but as The Stranger. But one of the things about, you read Richard Howard's translations of Barthes and it's like, wow, I can read French.
But Richard Howard, I think you're actually agreeing with the point there, because Richard Howard is a poet and is a writer in his own right and has got an interpretation of Barthes, no? I mean, Barthes' language isn't so complicated, but it is a...
Okay, I'll go further then. I'll say it makes you think you're reading French in Roland Barthes' own handwriting. And I've had so many great experiences. I'm always struck by the way that often, Bernhard, people say you've got to read, people go on like this. Yeah, you've got to read Bernhard in German, but the translations are great. I take the point that I'm going to be missing out on something, but I've had some great translated experience. So great that I've not even been conscious I've been reading a translation.
Thank you for coming, and thank you also for having us both. Thank you, Geoff.
Thank you, Gaby.